This conference will now be recorded.
So I'm sharing my screen to the to all of you, those who are online, and just confirm me whether it is visible to you. Is it visible for all of you?
Yeah, we can see.
Yep. Thank you. And for online people, the request is please mute your machines. If you have questions, type in the chat box. Okay. So now let's start discussing Python. I'm giving a backup for the last week sessions. So what is Python now? Let's understand. It's an, when you talk about Python, you know very well, most of you know this. It's an object oriented, simple, interpreted, and open source. So I'm going to talk quickly about all this, whatever is necessary. We are going to have a quick light on these concepts, what we have done, okay? And this is, we are doing it from the very beginning. And I see new faces in the offline session. So even online, we have so many new people today. That's why I'm going to give a quick backup for the next 1 hour. So please be patient, those who had already attended that sessions, okay? Now, when you talk about this, as we had already understood that it's object-oriented, simple, interpreted, and open source, okay? Now the question is open source programming language, that's fine. I'm not going to read everything from the notepad. Just for backup, I am using this. Later on, it will be a dynamic session. I'll be discussing the topic and you'll be implementing it, okay? Coming to the point, object-oriented in sense, it should have certain features. What are those features? Something like object, class, abstraction, encapsulation, inheritance. Okay, and then polymorphism. Okay, so please mute your machines, folks. Message passing and dynamic binding. People, even we don't need to add this polymorphism, I mean, message passing and dynamic binding only. These are the core OOP principles. And if any language has these principles, we call this as what? This is an object-oriented program, OOP. Now I am not going to spend much time on these concepts or topics, because in advanced Python, the whole discussion is about object-oriented programming. If you don't have any clarity about OOP, it is my responsibility to make sure that you get a clear picture about this OOP. So you don't need to think about that or worry about that thing. Now then, what I'm going to do right now? Right now we are going to focus on core Python, means functional programming. We'll talk on that. Okay, maybe again, you might ask me a question, what is functional, what is core, all this. I'm going to give clarity about each and everything. Mostly 98 to 99%, if you just listen to the session, you get clarity about most of the things. Okay, a few things here and there might be, you might have some doubts. Otherwise, you will be ready to implement something once the topic is discussed. That, so we will discuss very clearly, slowly. Make sure that you are clear with your understanding. And then I'll give you a problem. You should solve that problem. That's how this session goes. This needs some patience, and really this needs a bit of more dedication, and then you can do this. Okay, so coming to the point, as I discussed, Python is object oriented, that's fine. Then simple, yes, I had worked in different technologies so far, like Java, Python, and right now I am a senior big data consultant working for an MNC. So point is, after looking at Java and Python, I understood one thing. I'm not saying they are bad. all languages has their own strengths and weaknesses. But Python is somehow, I felt it's much more simpler than Java. Okay, if you ask me which one you choose to implement some automation, we can do the same with Java and Python, but I choose Python, I don't choose Java. Because of its easiness. Got the point, right? It is easy to implement and easy to understand and simple to apply also. Got it right? So that is one thing. That's why simple in sense, that is that. Interpreted, what is this? Interpreted in sense, I'll talk about these points here to give you a clear idea about what is interpreted. Generally, you know, when you talk about languages, we have two types of languages. One is scripting languages and compiled languages. When you talk about scripting languages, even Python is also called, it's object-oriented, interpreted scripting language. Why? Because when you talk about any scripting language, these scripting languages uses interpreter. Internally, they uses something called interpreter. I'm just giving you clarity here. Those who are new for this session, sir. Then I'll go to, back to these differences quickly. So when you see this, interpreted in sense, we have two things, two types of languages, what we call it as compiled languages. The other one is, please mute your machines, folks. Compiled languages and interpreted languages. You know it, right? You know, again, what is a language? All of you know this. What is a language? Language is a vehicle to develop software. What is it? Maybe I'll start from very beginning. This is A for our Python. What is language is A. Before that, we don't have any fundamentals, isn't it? So we are starting from A itself. So you don't need to think that you don't know Python. Second thing, you don't need to have any knowledge to understand Python. But if you know already any language, it's added advantage. I don't say that you should know anything. If you know it, it's good for you. So, okay. Coming to the point, a language means it is a vehicle to develop software. It is a vehicle. Usually, you know, you develop softwares with language. That is one thing. And we have two types of languages, high level and machine. High level in sense, who understands this? User understands this. It is user understandable language. Okay. Come in, come in. So like English, like what we call, generally we can say it's something like English, like for some of you, you know, please be patient. We'll finish this backup and switch to our discussion. For example, all your languages like C, CPP, Java, Python, anything English like, we call it as what? High level, okay, etc. Machine sense, binary language. Okay, machine language, it's nothing but machine understandable. What is that? Machine understandable. Or we can also say it's a binary language. So what is that binary language? Nothing but zeros and ones. That's all. So these are the two types. Now, I think this is clear, right? Which language do you use? Do we use high level or do we use a machine? We use high level languages. Machine is not for us. Machine or binary is for machine hardware, your computer or laptop or anything. Okay. Now, this high level, we can develop, we can divide into two types. What we can do? This high level, we can divide into two types. These are compiled and interpreted languages. What is compiled language? Of course, the definition is so simple. These are executed by compiler first. Who executes compiled languages? A compiler. That is a simple point, but still there is a discussion here. We need to talk more on this. Interpreted means these are executed by interpreter. Then immediately your question is difference. If you are new, you ask me difference, but as you are real time people, most of you are real time, you don't have that question. I know very well. So simple, what is compiler? It's very simple. You write a program, that entire program is executed at a time from high level to machine. You got the point? We write a program, you write 100 lines, 1000 lines, 10,000 lines of code in a program. That whole program is converted to machine or some intermediate code at a time. So what is compiler doing here? Compiler executes whole code at a time, and that's what we call on fly. Okay, so that's the point. Maybe I can quickly show you in Paint. Okay, so you write a program like this. It might be some high level program. It can be anything like your .py or okay, I'm using Java because Python is interpreted. It's Java or C, C++, something like this. Now you know, you compile this program. When you compile this program, what do you get? You get some intermediate code, depends on the type of language. It's something, it will be something like bytecode. Okay, or .obj code, something like this. You don't need to understand all this stuff. Okay, you don't need to remember, I'm sorry. You just have some idea, but you don't need to remember. If you want, you can forget it. Okay, bytecode or .obj, that's what we get. Again, when this is executed, I'm just quickly giving you the execution flow here. And when this is executed, what happens? We get an output here. Okay, this is how the execution flow happens. So here there are two phases. The first phase, there will be a compiler in this case. And this compiler converts this whole program, which you write in Java or C or C++, into this intermediate code that can be bytecode or .obj. And this is executed by some programs like, you know, like JVM or Linker, which is something like this. You understand this, right? So this, when this intermediate code is given to the JVM or some linker, some kind of program, that will execute this bytecode and give you the output. Means again, this bytecode or intermediate code is converted to machine code, and that machine code is executed. Finally, we get some output. And this here, what compiler is doing is, it is executing the whole program at a time. You got the point, right? So this is one thing. So one, what is that? It will execute this entire program at a time. So that's compiler. What compiler do? It executes a program from high level to machine on fly in a single take. In movies, sometimes we call single take artist. So the shot will be done in one time. Okay. Executes whole code at a time. Okay, next one. What about interpreted languages? Executed by interpreter, as I say that. Then second thing, what interpreter does? What is difference here? If it is interpreted here, of course, it's not Java or CPP or C++. Interpreted languages are Python, all scripting languages. Easy to understand is any scripting is an interpreted language. What is that? Python, JavaScript, VBScript, Shell script, any other scripting, these are called interpreted languages. And they are executed by interpreters. and they execute code line by line. They don't execute the whole program, but what they will do, they will take a line, convert it to machine code, execute that, come to the next line, convert it to machine code, execute it. So what happens here? If the same thing, if you are showing for an interpreter, what it does, we don't have these two phases like this. First thing, observe carefully. If you are using compiled languages, we have two phases. One phase to convert from high level to machine, another phase from, sorry, high level to intermediate code, another phase from intermediate code to machine code and output. You understand this, right? But when you talk about interpreted languages, you don't have these many phases. Okay, you have just only what do you have? You have just only one phases. First thing, suppose this is a .py program. Okay, we are using .py, okay, or .js, JavaScript, or anything else, or .sh, any shell script program. Point is simple. Usually interpreter will execute what? Line by line of code. What it does, sir? It executes a line by line. Understood? And here if you see, you will get output directly. Again, there won't be another phase here. You get output directly. No intermediate code for compiled languages. Are you following this? Sorry, no intermediate phase for interpreted languages. I told compiled. Understood, no? But which is faster here? Is it compiled or interpreted? Compiled languages are faster because they do on fly. Here, the code has to execute line by line, so it takes time. And interpreter is slower than compiler. This is one important difference. You got it right? But these are all very basic. See, for you people at this level, we don't need to talk all this. But only thing is, I see some of the freshers were also in this session, so I'm trying to give them some quick understanding. Okay, so now, are you good now? So finally, compiler is this, interpreter executes what? Line by line. Line by line. Okay, now let me switch to the differences between scripting and interpreted languages. Are you good right now? Those who are new, are you following? For old people, I know it's little, you know, boring or something. Give me just quick some time, we'll finish off it. Excuse me. So what is the difference between scripting and compiled languages? It's simple. When you talk about scripting, these languages are interpreted based languages, and they are executed line by line, and you don't have any exe for scripting languages, no exe, and you don't need to compile it like for compiled languages. When you run it, you get directly output. And other important point is, interpreter is slow here. What is it? Interpreter is slow compared to compiler. And examples for interpreted languages: Perl, Python, Perl, JavaScript, etc. In a simple, just quick conclusion, any language executed by interpreter are interpreted languages. You understand, right? They are interpreted languages. Got it right? The difference is they don't have two phases, just one phase. You give input, you get output directly. No intermediate phase here. But for compiled languages, you have intermediate phase that I have explained clearly with the diagram. And same thing for compiled. These are executed by compiler. And here you have two phases. And the program is executed, the whole program is executed from high level to some intermediate code or machine code at a time. Usually it happens to intermediate and then that to machine code if it is compiled language. And you have a .exe files here. And for some languages, you may not have .exe, like Java. Java don't have .exe. C and C++ has .exe. Understood? So, but anyhow, here we have two phases, but for here, for scripting, you have just only one phase. That's it. Next one. Let's talk about Python now. This is about difference between scripting, interpreted and compiled languages. If it is interpreted, what is the pointer? These are executed by interpreters. That is the pointer. And finally, line by line execution happens, but it's a bit slow. Got it, right? Compile means executed by compilers. It happens on fly, and we have multiple phases here. That's the difference. Now let's get to the point of features of Python. Why should we learn Python? There are many reasons. Why do we need Python? It is object oriented. Now this decade is the era of OOP, object oriented programming languages. Are you following? So now the second thing, it is interpreted. Now you know what is interpreted, executed by interpreters. And anyhow, while doing coding, I will clearly show you. I will prove all these points one by one. Whatever I discuss here, we will see that practically and understand. Next one, extensible means, we'll talk about extensible point a little later. Second thing, why people are so what fond of Python, or why they are so much interested in learning Python? Reasons, let me tell you. One thing, this is one important point. What is that? It has extensive libraries. Why nowadays people are preferring to use Python? Because you have so many libraries in Python, it's easy to implement. Unlike Java or C or C++, okay, you don't need to struggle to write lot of lines of code. You have less lines of code here, you don't have more lines of code. But people say that 100 lines in Java is one line in Python. That is actually not correct. 100 lines, if you write in Java, at least you write 10, 20 to 30 lines in Python. That is there. Understood? For sometimes when you are implementing logic, number of lines in Java and Python will be same. Only coding syntax changes. Many people don't know this. Because when you work in project, you understand that. When you just teach from books or websites, we don't know that. You understand it, right? So now, why it's popular? Because of extensively. Even, you know, when we say Python, people remember data science nowadays. Am I right or wrong? If I say Python, what people remember? Data science or big data or some analytics. Why? Because of the libraries which Python provides. No other language has such extensive libraries like what Python gives you. That is one important thing. Second thing, it's simple. Third thing, it is OOP. Fourth thing, again, it's actually, you know, it uses implicit data types. You don't need to use data types in Python. What is that? Python uses, what is that? Implicit means strongly and dynamically typed. What do you mean by dynamically typed? You don't use data type. Python automatically uses data type. For example, let me just show you. Excuse me. I have already installed Python, but it's not difficult. I'll show to all of you also. This is a Python compiler. I'm just increasing the size here, font size. Okay, can you see this now? I say a equal to 10 and I'm printing a. Did we get the output? Did I declare any data type here? Did I use any data type? Please mute your machines. This is right. Suppose if it is Java, or if it is C, or if it is C++, you need to declare data. Okay. But here I am not using any data type. Is this clear to all of you now? Does this mean that there is no data type? Yes, there is data type. What is this data? Integer. Suppose I use a function like this type of this type function tells data type of a variable. We'll talk on this. We didn't start anything yet. What it's saying, it is an int. Do you have data type here or not? But did I declare data type? Who declared this? System had defined it. Are you following, guys, sir? So that's simple idea. So that is dynamically typed. So Python is strongly and dynamically typed. Understood, no? Means you don't define data type, automatically your Python will declare data types. But you need to have idea about it. Another important, multi-paradigm. What do you mean by multi-paradigm? It supports functional programming as well as it supports object-oriented programming and iterative program. Okay, it's not imperative, it's iterative. Okay. That is multi-paradigm. Yes, you can write code like in C programming or like in R, like Java kind of code. So it has different styles of coding. You can choose whatever you need here. Are you following? Next one. It is an open source. It is free and open source. Are you following? Open source means it's free of cost. You don't need to pay any money for the Python. Okay. So these are all important features of Python. Why we should learn Python means? Reasons are simple. Python is useful for implementing many popular technologies like data science, big data, or AWS. It is used for automation. Second thing, what is that? It's easy to learn. Third thing, it supports multi-paradigm. You can implement coding in functional approach or OOP approach or imperative approach. And also extensive libraries. No other language has this many libraries what Python provides you. Okay. And portable, of course. Portable in sense, we can execute Python from one platform to another platform. That is also there. So that's idea about Python. Understood now? Next one, applications. It's everywhere. It has scientific applications. You automatically understand this when we start discussing slowly one by one. You have business applications, console based, audio video applications, CAD applications, enterprise applications, images, data analytical applications. Okay, automation, like, you know, network applications, it supports whatnot. If you talk about Python, it provides you libraries for everything. You name something, Python has a library for that. That's how it is designed nowadays. Are you following, guys? Is it clear for all of you? So next one. Language fundamentals. See, I'm just, you know, backing up this. Yes, please. I'm just giving a quick backup. The detailed session is there in my YouTube channel. It might be this name. You can name, know this. The recorded is there in my channel, which has happened last week. Manohar learn well or learn well tech. I changed it to learn well. Please, if you want to go through detailed learn well tech, this is my any one of this try any one of these channel names. That complete detailed recorded session is there in my channel. You can go and go through it today once this session is done. I'm just giving a quick backup because those who miss this, so that they get some idea. Got it right? Right, next one. Now let's talk about language fundamentals. What is that? See, if you want to write any program in Python, you need to have not just in Python, any language. We need to have idea about language fundamentals. What are those language fundamentals? Something like variables, constants, data types, operators, all this. So variable means what? What is a variable? It's a name given to a value in a program. It's a name given to a value in a program. You are using this in mathematics from your childhood. Okay, like in Python, we don't have a specific syntax to declare variables. It's very straightforward, as you don't have data types. It is variable name equal to value, something like this. Some a equal to 10. Directly, it's more like, you know, it's very general form. It's not like any too technical form. Like, you know, like some x equal to 10.5, something like this. Or some s equal to, okay, learn well, string. You don't need to understand, just I'm giving an idea about variables. I'm doing a recap for all this now. This is a backup. You get a quick understanding within next 20 minutes to half an hour about all these data types. Okay, now, so means this is very straightforward in Python. You don't need to use any data types. Are you following this? So what is syntax for declaring variable? Variable name equal to value. I'm a little slow here just because it is the starting, so, but later on you will be doing more, not me. Next one, rules. Actually, how should we declare variables in Python? A variable should start with the alphabet or underscore. That's possible. That is one thing. Second thing, it can have digits, but the variable should start with what? Alphabet or underscore. After that, you can have digits. Are you following? Digits are allowed. When it is allowed? Either after alphabet or after underscore, not in the beginning. Don't use any special symbols. Don't use any space. Okay. Are you following this? So what are the rules here? It should start with the alphabet or underscore. Next, it can have digits, but following rule one. Third, don't use special symbols or spaces except underscore. Underscore is allowed, but other special symbols are not allowed. Excuse me, guys. Okay, let's quickly understand. So this is the first variable. You just type in the chat box ABC 123. Is it valid or invalid? Valid. It starts with alphabet, then you have numbers after alphabet. 123 ABC, valid or invalid? Are you sure? Why it's invalid? It starts with this. It's guys, are you following? I just you know make it crispy here. I optimized the session, that almost 2 hour session for you to get quick idea. Okay, next one. Underscore 123, valid or invalid? Please type in the chat box if you want to be interactive with this session, folks. Because when everybody starts talking, again, it becomes a fish market. That's why I'm asking to chat, okay? ABC.123, valid or invalid? Why invalid? ABC dollar 123, valid or invalid? Why? If you ask me, sir, how can I test it? Means if you simply open your this one, your Python prompt. This is called prompt, interactive mode. If you are doing anything in this black prompt, this command prompt for Python, it's called what mode? Interactive. It is used for quick testing. But in real time, we don't use this much. We need to write batch mode, batch programs. Means you have to write it in the form of a file. We'll talk on this. The coming sessions, we do more on batch programs, not interactive. But sometimes for quick discussion, quick analysis, we use interactive. But how many modes of coding is there in Python? Two modes. What are those two modes, sir? One is a interactive, second one is a batch. Difference? Interactive is for quick testing and it is directly your command prompt. Okay, so you see now, coming back to the pointer, I'm asking about variables. To test whether this variable is valid, you just see here, you simply say something like this, ABC123 equal to 10. Did you get any error? Now you see ABC.123, you say this, gentleman. Do you have syntax error here? Yes, sir. Means it's very clear. If you violate rules, it leads to syntax error. Are you following or not? If you violate rules, it gives you syntax errors. So following this, no, if you want to become write good code in Python, you don't need to be intelligent, or you don't need to have 90% or 80% in your academics. I don't say if it is there, I am not saying it's bad. It's good only. But many people ask me, because nowadays I'm training more of real-time people. In the beginning, I used to train for freshers. The question that comes from me is, sir, I have 60% or 59%, can I learn programming? If you are hungry, anybody can eat food, isn't it or not? Programming is also that only. If you are really passionate to implement something, even if you are 35 marks also, you can do it. I'm just only trying to tell you the, make you understand that to do coding, you don't need to have anything else. Myself, I have 35 marks in my BTech, sorry, my graduation, BSc. My computer marks just pass. Got the point, right? But right now I'm working as a big data consultant, senior big data, where we need to apply Java, we need to apply Python, we need to apply Scalar, all different codes of this thing we have to write. It's Spark as a framework. Now, I'm not trying to say I'm something great. That is not my point here. Got it, right? Being a past student, just past guy, I am able to do coding for different languages now. Many of you are far better than me. You would have got good grades in your academics. So it is not difficult to write programming, keep in mind. But what matters, why this point came here is, what matters is understanding these rules, understanding syntaxes in the beginning clearly is very important. Then automatically you can implement, apply that in the code. I challenge with you, as I told you in the last week also. You concentrate clearly and be patient and listen to what I'm trying to tell. Definitely, you are going to write far better code, which you didn't imagine also in these sessions. I'm challenging with you because you are physically there. At least online people, they cannot come to me. You can beat me, no problem. Okay. Our goal is we have to do implementation, not learning all the concepts and assuming that Python is over. That approach never help you, trust me. After learning, you keep quiet for 2 months, everything gone out of coverage area. Nothing stand in your mind unless you apply. Okay, anyhow, I'm switching to my topic now. So here, finally, that's about this. Get clarity about these fundamentals, then only you can write code. Many people don't write code. This, I told you this point in the last class, again, I'm emphasizing. Many people feel that programming is difficult because they don't understand fundamentals clearly. Clear, right? So that's it. So that's about variables. Finally, conclusion is, it's just a name given to a value. It's just a name like you, like this boy, Kamal. When I say Kamal, physically everybody is there. That name identifies that person. Same thing, name identifies a value. Can we have duplicate names in programming? Duplicate variables are not allowed. It's not allowed in any language, not just Python. Okay, next one, constants. How many types of constants are there in programming? 4 types. What are those 4 types, gentlemen? Character, numeric, complex, boolean. In mute, you can also read out louder along with me. You know, as per research, when you read out, you can remember 50% of what you learn. And when you write, you can remember 80% of what you learn. Okay, so you can read out loudly along with me. Let's get into touch. I think all of you are good with variables, right? Dear online friends, are you fine? Is my screen visible to all of you? Somebody is saying screen is not visible. I am little confused. Means you have some, those who are not able to see my screen, my dear friends, you have network issue at your home. Because many people are able to see the my screen. Clear, right? Next one. I think I'm not boring you, right? Is it interesting to you? Okay. For some of you, bear me, okay? Because last week you have everything in the mind, I know. Did you forget any of those things? I'm sure. Character means what? In C, C++, you have 2 classifications. Single character, string, 2 classifications are there. But in Python, every character is a string. You don't have single character like that. Everything is string, that is character. Okay, and some people ask me this question in the beginning, and you need to get a perfect understanding here to write a bigger code. What are character constants? Alphabets, digits, special symbols, words. Sometimes people ask me this question, sir, you told character constants, fine, but you are telling digits. But digit is number. How come it's character, sir? This is the question I you frequently get from where? Excuse me. Frequently. Can you just put it outside? Sorry for the disturbance. So these are the question is this, how come it's character? It's very simple to understand. Characters will be always in quotes. What characters always will be in? Suppose you are going to office. How do you know that you are an employee of office? Everybody in the office has to put that tag or not. Then you are an employee, isn't it? Same thing. When you say some type of data, it has some kind of characteristics. And character has to be in quotes. And pure digits, numbers are not in quotes. They won't be in quotes. That is the simple difference. You got the point, right? What is that? Numbers are not in quotes, but characters are in quotes. And in Python, we can declare string in single quotes, double quotes, and triple quotes. The single and double quotes are declaring for single line statements. What line statements are? Single line like this. This triple quotes is used for declaring comments or multi-line statements. What is that? The single quote or double quote. Both of these are for what line statements? Used to as in single line statements. I will prove all this single line statements. See, when I am explaining, if you don't understand, wait, no problem. When implementing, if you don't want, also you'll get a clear understanding. Okay. And this is also for single line statements. Okay, and triple quote is for multi-line statements. Are you following, gentlemen? Or this is also used for comments. What is that? You know comments, right? To describe your code, we use comments. We'll see more on that. Right? Are you good now? Next one. Everything in quotes is treated as string in Python. Okay, there is no single character, but if you want to single character, we can do some type conversions, that is there. But directly you don't have single character. Everything is string in Python, and it is in single quote or double quote or triple quote. It can be declared in any of these three forms. For example, I say s equal to, I'm just taking a simple one, just Python. Which quote is this? Double quote. I'm taking single quote for this. We don't need music right now in the classroom, okay? If you just listen to class, it's enough. Everybody is finally, right now, they were not tired, okay? I appreciate for that efforts to make sure that you are concentrating. Clear now? Okay. Next one. Where is triple quotes now? Did I use triple quotes, sir? Okay, now let's see. I'll just use triple quotes. 1, 2, 3. I can write this in triple quotes. But usually it's not just for single line. If you put one line also, it will agree. But triple quotes is meant for what? Let me press enter. You can print S. Got it right? Understood or not? But single quote and double quotes are used for single line statements. Triple quotes for? If you want to know more about it. If you want to have more, if you want to get some bigger understanding, better understanding, you don't need to break your head this stage. We'll talk about it little later. Okay, we'll get a clear idea while doing implementation. Next one. After this, sir, what is the data type used to declare string by Python? And this is very important to remember. It's not something difficult. Use this function to know data type. What data type we should use, sir? What is the function we should use to know the data type of variable? Type function, type of S. Enter. What is it showing here? So what is the data type used by Python to declare string in Python? Str. It's a class. We'll talk about it. If you ask what is a class, I'll give explanation for every dot and comma in the programming. Okay, you don't need to worry, just listen right now. Are you good now? Next, after this. Now that's about character constants. I hope you got clear idea. If you didn't get, I'm just quickly concluding it. We have four types of constants: character, numeric, and complex and boolean. Characters means it's the alphabets or digits or special symbols or words. And this has to be in quotes. What are those quotes? Single, double, and triple. And you have three types of declarations here. Okay. Next, after that, every character is a string in Python. Remember. And the data type used to declare string in Python is that is used by your Python interpreter itself. We are not going to declare. Are you good now? Next. Numeric constants. What is numeric constants? All numbers. We have generally two types, integer and decimal. Integer is something without a fraction, something whole numbers. And suppose you just take a small example, you say a equal to 10. And a equal to in single quote. Okay, oh yeah, I'll go to that point again. Now what is this integer? Print a. If you just type that alphabet, that variable name there, your interpreter will automatically show the value. You don't need to do anything. Now I want to know the data type of this variable. Then what should I do, gentlemen? Use which function? Type of a. What is showing here? Are you following? You have to note all these data types. What you have to do? Okay, make a note of all this in your notes, because we need that after this. The next session, type conversion, there you need all this. Suppose I say a equal to, in single quotes I give 9 here. In single quotes I give 9 here. Tell me, is it a integer or is it a character? Okay, character or string, same, right? Now you tell me, is it integer or character? Are you sure? You got the difference? When it's character, when it is not, enter. For proof, to prove that, what is that? It is a, to prove that it is string, it is not number, or it is not integer, use which function? Type of a? What did you get? Is it showing integer? No. Now you got clear difference? I told you. I will, whenever time comes, again we will touch base all the concepts which we have discussed here and get a better picture. You don't need to worry if I am not explaining in deeper. Okay. Right. Next one. Decimal, number with fraction. You know, real numbers. How do you declare that? Suppose x equal to some 10.5. What is this, sir? How do I know data type of this? Because by default we don't use data types, because Python syntax for variable is just a variable equal to value. Just you need to use which function? Type of a x. You keep parallelly practicing, guys. You download this Python online. Those who are new to the sessions, what I recommend is you go to Python website 1 minute before. Okay, click on this python.org and go to the downloads. Okay, in this downloads you can see downloads for Windows. Click on that, and then the latest version is this. Click on this and go to the down. Otherwise you can directly download the one it is showing. It's by default which version? It's a 3.0. And here if you see for that 3.8 version, for 64 bit you download this Windows 8664 executable installer. Okay, and for 32 bit you download this Windows 86 executable installer. You can choose any one of these two, depends on your operating system. Is this difficult? Nowadays fifth class students are also doing. Kamal is eighth class. I had a sixth student earlier in some one session, like 1 year back, and she had a YouTube channel also. You got it right? Point is simple. These are very simple things. Kids are doing these things nowadays. So you got it right. Come to this downloads, choose the version which you want. Okay. And then download it. And then after downloading, what you have to do? Should I tell you this also? Go to that exe file. Once you download, what you have to do, I'll show that also to you. Okay. Very difficult task for you. Okay. You have this, right? I have already installed it in my machine. Double click on the download, that exe file. Okay, you double click it and then say what? Next, next, next. And in the beginning, what you have to do is do one thing. This is your Python software. Double click on this. Okay, this Python software. And here, do one thing. you have to select this checkbox. This is very important, so that your Python path is added to environment variables. So when you open command prompt and just type Python, you can see that command Python prompt. Otherwise, you have to set environment variables for Python. Okay, you got it right? So this is one. After that, I don't need to do. You have see, you can see here install now. Click on that and say next, next, next. Online folks, please do this now immediately. Make sure your software is ready so that you can practice with me parallelly. Understood, right? I have already this in my machine, so I am not doing next, next, next. If you are disappointed if I for that, I am sorry. But clicking on next is not difficult, okay? These two things are important for you. Clear now? Select this checkbox also. And then click, say install now. That's all, okay? Got it right? All of you are ready with your softwares now? Once that is done, open command prompt and click on Python here. Just type here Python in command prompt. It will automatically give you the prompt. Okay. Then now you can start working along with me. Understood? So right, that's all. If you still have doubt, go to this video again. Just open it, drag to this point somewhere around 1 hour or like that, sir, 45 minutes. Then you have this there, okay? Good now? Next. That's about decimal. Decimal means number without a number with fraction. That is decimal. We have seen examples here. What is the data type for decimal? Float. We are almost done. Complex numbers. What are complex numbers? Numbers with a form like A plus BJ. This is a complex form. And J is a prefix, sorry, suffix. You should use for imaginary part. Don't use I, X as you like in maths, okay? Here there is a standard complex form. That standard complex form is A plus BJ. Means A and B values can be any constants here. This is only just a form representing format here, that's all. Okay, and J must or should not change. It has to be J throughout your complex numbers. Anywhere you define complex number, always make sure that suffix is J. Like means, I'll show you here. Something like 10 plus 20J. Sorry. 10 plus 20J. Got it right? And you can assign that to a variable also, x equal to 10 plus 20j. And print that x. Understood, right? Visible? Clear now? All of you are good. This is about constants. So how many constants are there? Four constants. What are those four constants? People on online, you can also answer even though if I don't listen, but you keep answering. How many constants are there? Character, constant, numeric, complex and boolean. Could you tell me what is the data type we use for character constant? Not we, what your interpreter uses. What is that? What is the data type used for integer? Integer. Decimal. Decimal. Then what is the constant used for complex? You didn't try it, right? Use type function. Whenever you have such doubt, what you have to do? Apply which function? Come here, simply just say type of what? Type of x. You can see here now what it's showing here. That is the data type of complex number, okay? So you can add that. Last one, boolean. What is boolean? Boolean means true or false. The first letter in both the literals, these are built-in literals. The T or F has to be uppercase, no other case you should use. Okay? In Java, it is a completely lowercase. These are built-in literals. In Python, these two has to be starting with the uppercase. Okay, you just see here now. So Boolean means just true or false. X equal to true, print X, and then again Y equal to false, print Y. You can see there something is wrong. Whenever you get, if it is showing like that, you are doing something wrong in your code. Okay, false and print Y. Suppose if I give fs lowercase, it will read through an error. I told you it has to start with the uppercase. Both the true and false must be in uppercase. You understand that, right? We are done with constants. Next one, data types, already we are done. And what is the data type for Boolean again? What is data type for Boolean? Type of, what you have to do, type of a X. Is this difficult to do this kind of programming? Kamal is doing, means everybody can do. Am I right or wrong? Bool. You make a note of, list out all this in your notes. And finally, next one. That's about data types. Now you tell me, what is the data type used to declare Boolean constants, sir, gentlemen and ladies? Bool. Are you clear now? And this is what this phase we have discussed in the last sessions, last two sessions, right? I had made it a little quick and okay, optimized. I told you, right? You don't need to worry that all these sessions, whichever detailed, it's there in YouTube. If you have patience and if you want to go through each and every you know point, go through that session and okay, get a better understanding. I am just keeping these sessions in YouTube just for your convenience only. Okay, data types in Python, already you know now. Yes or no? Don't you have idea about data types now? While discussing constants itself, we came to know about data types. Now let me summarize this. String, what is this str? Okay, that's fine. Why do we use this? Str is used for declaring string by interpreter. Int, float, complex, bool. These are all the data types. What is the data type finally? I would like to know the definition. Quick question to all of you. Data type. What is a data type? Data type is a keyword or a class. In some languages, it is a keyword, but in Python, it is a class. If you ask me difference, sir, I'll talk on this. Don't worry. By the end of your 2 months or 3 months, if you are not clear with what, all these things, then you can come and ask me. I told you, right? So data type, simple. It tells about data type. Type of data, you name as you like. Suppose I just type here 10 folks. What is this? 10, number without fraction. Number without fraction means what, sir? Integer, right? Which key, which class is used here? Not keyword. Which class is used here? Int class. Yes or no? That is the means when I give you data, when I type data there, are you able to recognize what type of data is that or not? You are giving me the key, that class name also. What is this? Decimal. What is the class name declared for this? You got some idea? Looking at data itself, you understood data type. Means, suppose when I put float here, suppose I put float here, what do you understand? When I say float, you remember decimal values again. Means this defines decimal. Got it, right? Means when you look at data type, automatically you recognize, okay, this is used to declare this decimal data. When I type int, you recognize this is used to declare this int data. Yes or no? But for that to understand, you should have a clear idea about constants. This is where people don't understand properly and they come to a conclusion, programming is difficult. If you don't understand this basic data types, all this stuff, obviously programming is difficult. But if you understand all this and try coding, understood, right? Then you tell me if it is really difficult, then you can try something else. Got it, right? Okay, let's. Now, are you ready for doing some very basic programs? What we call baby class programs. Shall we start from there? In the last session, we have done few programs. We'll talk about installation, all that. I didn't discuss installation of IDEs so far with anyone. I will discuss what IDEs we need to use, and we try all the IDEs on a touch basis. And we use PyCharm regularly in our sessions. If you want Anaconda, you can use Anaconda or Spider. That's your choice. Anaconda is a meta framework. They have so many, again, frameworks inside that. Okay, now we'll come to operators again. Programs, folks. Are you ready, online folks, to write some programs? Finally, I taught you something so far. If I want to know the data type of some variable in Python, because there is no direct data type, then which function should we use here? All of you are very clear. Kamal, which function should we use? Okay, I'll ask you later. Okay, are you ready now? Ready for writing first program? Write a program. Now you got idea about variables. Are you sure? Are you clear with variables? Say yes or no.
Yes.
Are you clear with constants?
Yes.
Are you clear with data types, sir?
Yes.
And keywords. One more thing is keywords. Keywords, you don't need to worry too much about it. They are built-in words. Whenever we discuss, I will remind you this is a keyword. And we have to use them as it is, no change. Okay, keywords are predefined or what is that? Are built-in words. Like, you know, like if, else. Okay, and, or. Okay, so many are there. Around 25 to 30 keywords are there in Python. Class, something like this. You don't need to note them. Not necessary. If you add it, nothing wrong. Okay, one important rule is, I told you in the last class, and for you who are new, never ever use keyword as a variables or identifiers. Suppose you see, folks, I told you keywords, not class names. Okay, I say something like this. What is that? If equal to some 20. If is a keyword, just now I mentioned. If you don't know, now I am telling. If is a keyword. I used it as variable out of my foolishness. Then press enter. What happened? What it saying? What it saying? Invalid syntax. You have a toothbrush. Why do we use toothbrush? For brushing teeth only. Will you use it for clearing your ears, sir? Keyword means you have to use it for whatever the purpose it is defined. It is meant for declaring certain things. Do that. Don't use as variables. It's wrong. You understand the point? Yes or no? So guys, sir, now you don't need to use any keywords for these basic programs. Just minimum common sense. I told you in the last class, again, I am telling you this. Even a rickshaw person has a common sense. If you give 50 and if you have, you know, discussed your what is that charges for 20 rupees, you'll give 30 rupees automatically, isn't it or not? You don't teach him mathematics after getting down, right or wrong? Common sense is there for everyone. Improving that depends on your interest and patience and dedication. Okay, now first program, let's write it. Write a program. This is people, this is like, you know, very beginning program. People start here. Because already we have declared variables now. Usually we start there. Declaration all of us has seen. You practice parallelly, online folks. Otherwise, okay, we are not going to get productivity here. Next, write a program to find a sum of two numbers. This is the first program you have written in your graduation or post-graduation. All BTech folks, civil, mechanical, electrical, triple E. Okay, EC, computer science, IT. Is this the first program you wrote, right? Hello World is first program. Our Python Hello World is so simple. If you want Hello World, do you want Hello World, folks? What is Hello World here? Simple. S equal to, just simply say in double quotes, hello, directly in double quotes, hello at your prompt, world. You want Hello World means, let's start there. Got Hello World? But initialize to a variable, that's good habit. What is that? Initialize to a Hello World. How do you print? How do you print in Python? We have to use which function? Print of Hello World. If you are not satisfied, if you want to see something like printf in C, cout in C++, system.out.in, println in Java, okay, then use a print function like this. Hello World is this. This is our Python style. You don't need any program structure here for Python, but for Java, C, all this needs structure. One more difference between scripting and compiled languages. All compiled languages has a program structure, but for Python or any scripting languages, you can directly test statements like this. You don't need to have a structure. Are you good now? Hello World is there. Now you start doing next program. What is our next program? All of you know how to declare variables? You know how to define variables or not? Var name equal to value. You know about constants. Okay. Now, sum of two numbers. Did you try this program? No? All of you, right? Do this now. Solve it. From now onwards, whenever topic comes, I will explain it clearly once or twice. After that, I'll give a problem. You solve it. That's what I told you. If you want to learn programming, then these sessions are good. If you want to complete course, then this is not recommended. We'll finish course, but with the implementation. And those who has that interest and patience and discipline, attend these sessions. Finished it? I am writing this very difficult and tough program. Shall I? How many variables should I declare? Two is enough here first. What are two? I mean, three are required. First to define how many? So A equal to 10, B equal to 20, C equal to A plus B. Okay, and then how do I print it?
Print C or C.
Print of a C. I'll explain more on print statement. Don't worry. Don't worry about it. We'll talk. This is program. Let's test it. All of you, I hope you have downloaded your Python software, dear online friends. Because the problem is I cannot see you. You are whole in charge of yourself there, okay? Right. A equal to 10, B equal to 20, C equal to A plus B. Then finally print C here. Got 30? For this, to write this code, do you need any knowledge in any language? But behind this, there are so many things. Right now, you can answer those things. What is that type of A, no? Type of B? Type of C? And when I just declare that variable there, you are getting output. Means implicitly, again, it is using print. Interpreter is using print there. Are you following this? Okay, now that is first program. Ready for second program? Write a program. Write up. You can also use print here to print your value if you want. Not necessary. You can say print of C. Okay. Next. Another program. Other, I will give assignment for you. If you want solutions, you can try from the previous session. That video sessions are there. You can download or you do whatever you want. You can practice it. Write a program to find the area of a triangle. You know the formula of area of triangle, right? Area equal to half. In programming, use asterisk. You don't have into base into height. Okay. We have some music director in our team here. Whenever we are bored, he is giving us some music. No, just, you know, we have done a very serious session, so I don't know how to crack jokes. Little weak. Over. Yeah, you have already done it, right? I'm just giving you answer. I ask you to solve it. If you solve, then by the end of these sessions, definitely you will be doing next level of coding, which you didn't expect. So how many inputs I have to give here? B equal to 20, C, H equal to 30, A equal to 1 by 2 into half into base into height, and finally print it. Test it in your prompt. How many inputs are required here? Two inputs. So first define B equal to how much? Something of your choice. Int or decimal, it's up to you. Okay, usually it will be decimal values for these calculations, but it's up to you. A, B equal to 10, H equal to 5, A equal to half into base into H, and print A. See there, this is the program. But do you need to declare that B and H as it is? Is it necessary? Variables are your choice, folks. You can give X or Y instead of BH or A also. Instead of A, you can put some result. Variable names are your purely your choice, following the rules what we had discussed. Are you good with this? Understood. So that's about. And one more question to all of you. Suppose if you do the same, if you write the same logic, this is called logic or formula, in C and C++ and Java, you get zero as your output. Why? Because there this slash is in, this is a division. That is integer division in C, C++, Java, C sharp, in all these languages. But in Python, it is a decimal division. What division? When you use slash, it is decimal division. I'll talk about it clearly in operators. That is our next discussion. But remember, single slash means what it gives us? It is a decimal division in Python. What division? Okay, suppose if you do the same like this, double slash, enter, and print A. See your answer there. What is your answer? You got zero, right? Double slash in Python is for integer division. What division? Integer. Are you following or not? Anyhow, I'm going to explain operators. And when we go to the operators, I'm going to explain all this clearly. But when you write code, what is the process of writing code? First, you should always declare what? Variables. Look at the logic. See whatever variables are necessary. First, declare and initialize those variables. Declare and initialize those variables, then what? Write a logic, then display your result. That is the algorithm, small simple algorithm. How to write code? Always first declare what? Declare variables and initialize. Some of you might ask me a question, those who are from colleges. Sir, how do you input from keyboard? This is one thing which they like to ask. Don't worry, I'll show you all that also. Right now, I'm just trying to quickly give you some idea. Dynamic initialization, we'll discuss. For now, we are going with static initialization, okay? Always first declare what? variables and initialize. Second, after that, what you have to do? Write logic. After that, what you have to do? Print result. Following or not? This is how you have to write a program. Now, I'm going to the next topic after this. Are you good with all this now? All of you are on same page now? This is what I have discussed in last weekend, Saturday and Sunday. Okay, now you don't need to, your waiting is over. Those who had already attended, let's continue. Now, next topic is, what is our next topic? Operators. So what is an operator here, folks? It's a symbol which performs some operation. So this is a bit lengthy session. I know it's a little difficult, but what I suggest is pay attention, work with me, then you get good results. Okay. So now, what is an operator? How do you define it? It is a symbol which performs an operation. What operations? Addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, okay, and then power. In C, C++, all these languages, we have all this. What is that? Plus, minus, into, slash, percentile, and then that's all. For these are, you know, anyhow, let's talk about categories here in Python. So that's fine, it's a symbol, and we have all these types. Arithmetic, what types of operators are there? We have arithmetic, relational, logical, okay, and then we don't have unary here. We have assignment, okay, assignment is there. No unary, no ternary. If it is C, C++, you see unary, plus, plus, minus, minus. Okay, then you have bitwise, but bitwise are not necessary here for us. Bitwise operators are there. Are you following now? So now let's talk about arithmetic. Arithmetic in sense, plus, you see this from school days, plus, minus, into, this you know very well, addition, subtraction, and multiplication. This is for division, slash, single slash, it's a division, it gives quotient, but it performs a decimal division. What division? Decimal. If you ask me what is difference, I will show you with example. And percentile. Percentile gives what? It is also division, but it gives what? Percentile gives remainder. And double slash, what it gives? It is division, again quotient, but it performs what operation? Integer division. Are you following or not? So I'll just explain this with the small examples. Suppose I said 10 by 5. What is the output for this? 10 by 5. How much? 2.0. Suppose 10 double slash 5. How much I get? Just 2. Suppose 10 percentile 5. How much I get? How much I get? Reminder, it gives reminder. 5 divides 10 completely or not? So what is the reminder? 0. Shall I explain little? Shall I go to the little low level? Now I am at 5th class level. Shall I go to 1st class? No, I have a I can go to whatever level you want. You don't want first class, sir? Fifth is fine. Okay, I'm just you know trying to free you. I know you are not. This is not a big joke. Now, suppose let's get a better idea here. Okay, so I say, what is the difference between integer division and decimal division? Many people just can't. What is that? Relate to that. Let's have a clear difference. Suppose I take, I am dividing by 5. Which one I am dividing? 10. How many times it will go? Let's take this one. It's easy. It's better. 1 by 2 is best for us. Suppose this is what division? Single slash means a integer division. Double slash means a? Sorry, I'm sorry. Sorry, sorry, sorry. Single slash is a decimal. Double slash is a integer. And percentile is a remainder. It is also division. Now, what happens? This is our division. We are dividing by 2. Which one I am dividing? 1. What division is this? Decimal division. How many times it will go? Decimal means a fraction is accepted or not? Fraction accepted or not? So what is that? It is a 0 point. If you put point, it will you will add 0. School days maths. And then you put 5 here. How many times, sir? So when you are doing decimal division, point is allowed. What is allowed? Point is allowed. Are you following or not? So that's why you get output as what? What is your output now? 0. What is your quotient? But your remainder is a 0. Let's apply this for integer now. Are you clear with this? Next, do the same for integer. Suppose this is an integer division. I am taking do. Here we are doing 1 double slash 2. And here we are dividing 1 with 2. How many times it will go now? Just 0 times. No point. If no point, it will take just 0. 2 zeros, 0. What is output? What is remainder? Remainder is 1, but what is quotient? Remainder 1, but quotient is a? Are you following this? Can you see difference here between these two operations? Whenever you do integer division, then always your fractional part is rounded. It won't take that fraction. It is truncated. It is removed. It is cut. It will take only the left side part. Got it right? That's why integer don't give fractions. So the reason is simple now. Finally, what is that? When I do integer division here, what's happening? When I say 1 by 2, you get a 0.5 decimal division. 1 double slash 2, what I'm getting here? The 0. Got clarity now? That's it. Next. Suppose when I say 1 percentile 2, what do I get now? What do I get? Did you get 1 here? Can you see that? Hence proved. What?
1 power 2.
Thanks for that answer. Right, so now after this next operator, what is our next operator? What is that? Power. We don't need to talk about plus minus into. All of you can do that or not? What power gives, sir? Power gives power of your number. 2 power 2, how much? 3 power 2.
9.
Understood or not? That's what. Let's see. I think you need to please switch on that AC thing. And my friend, you please come and sit here. I know you have some issue with AC.
No, I don't have any issue, but he said that there is. But unfortunately, outside they have switched off. I don't know. I have
It's okay, fine.
Let me check.
So now let's continue. So I'll take a number here. What is that? A equal to 10. Can you see there? I'm applying power for that. So A asterisk asterisk 2. Don't use only 2 asterisks. Don't think if you give 3 asterisks, you'll get a cube. Okay. Don't think that. There is no 3 asterisks in Python. Enter. So can you see the output now? Got it? That's it, folks. Clear? Next, after that, so that's about arithmetic operators. Is it clear for all of you now? Any questions? Any questions? Next, after that, relational. Relational means what? Greater than, less than, and then greater than or equal, less than or equal, and then double equal, and then not equal. All these are what kind of operators? Comparison. These are used for comparison. Why do we use them? So relational operators are used to compare values. Next one. Another important point is any relational operation what is that? Returns boolean. What it returns? Boolean value. Are you following or not? Suppose you see now, I take 2 values here. Okay. So you see something like A equal to 10, B equal to 5. Can you see this, sir? These were my 2 values. Now I am saying A greater than B. Is it true or false? I am applying relational operator. Then you can see that A greater than B is returning what? True. Means what is the point here? Any relational operator returning what? Returns what?
Boolean.
Understood, no? Suppose I say A less than B, what is your answer? A is 10, B is 5. A less than B, what is this? True or false?
False.
Okay. And A greater than or equal to B, what is your answer? True or false? Because A is 10, B is 5. So is it true or false? It's true only. Greater than or equal, any one can be true. A less than or equal to B, true or false?
False.
A equal to B, true or false? These are all very small things. We learned this in 5th class or 4th class only. Next one, A not equal to B, true or false? So these are your answers. We can clear screen. Okay, we can apply some CLS, OS dot system of, okay. I'll just apply that. How to clear your screen? OS dot import. We have to do one thing. You should say import OS to clear off your screen. Then OS dot system of in single quote CLS. Then can you see this? Screen got cleared now. You might be wondering how to clear screen. CLR don't work, CLS, CLR, SCR don't work, clear don't work, CLS don't work. How to use clear statement in your prompt in Python? First we should import one package, that is a OS. Then after that, what should we do? Then after that you have to say OS dot system of all lowercase CLS, that will clear your screen. Okay.
So what does asterisk question mark mean?
Asterisk?
Question mark. No, exclamation mark and then equal to.
Not equal to. So you are saying this one, right? Are you good with this, folks? Next one after that. Relational means we are done now. Next, what else after that? Logical operators. What operators? Logical operators. What are logical and or not? All are keywords here. No symbols. When do we use this? Combine two or more conditions, and every condition should be true. If you apply AND operation, suppose you have three conditions. We combine all the three conditions, but if every condition should be true, then apply AND. Suppose if any one condition is false, what happens? The whole operation returns false. And if every condition should be true, apply this. Use what? Use AND operator. Suppose I have three or four conditions, I want to combine them, but any one condition can be true, then which one I should apply? OR. So same thing, combine two or more conditions, and if any one condition there are small typos, excuse me for that. Okay, combine two or more conditions, and if any one condition can be true, or one instance can one, it's not like it's just only one, minimum one condition has to be true if OR operation should be true. But more than one is also true, is it's fine with OR. All conditions are true, it's fine with OR. But if OR should return true, minimum how many conditions should be true? One. Understood or not? Suppose if you attended five interviews, you want to do job, you should get selected in how many interviews? At least one. Suppose if you get five, I will go to all jobs means, I'm just giving a small example to understand quickly. Understood, right? And is not like that. We prefer and to see that every condition in the given expression should be true. We'll see small examples now, simple examples. Are you ready for that? Suppose not for negation, not for negation. We'll talk on that. Now coming back to these examples for which one? And take two values, three values, A equal to 10, B equal to 5, C equal to 4. Now I want to check greatest of these three numbers. How can I do? I can do A greater than B and A greater than C. How many conditions are there? First I compared A with B, A with C, two are there. Now if I should combine these two conditions, I should use logical operator. When if I am checking for greatest of three numbers, which is best here? AND is recommended. Which is recommended? AND plus enter. True or not? If the any one of those values are satisfying the condition, you get false. Suppose if I use R, it doesn't make sense here, isn't it or not? I want to find greatest of three numbers. I say this, does it make sense in this context? R is not recommended in this case. Got it right? So that's how AND works. If every condition in the expression is true, AND returns true. If any one condition is false, suppose you have 10 conditions, out of that 9 are true, 1 is false, still it will return false. Remember this point clearly. What about R? Anyone. Suppose I have two subjects. Government gave us a concession. What is that? Subject 145, subject 2, 767, something like that. If you pass in any one subject, you are passed for your semester. Means, how do you frame this condition? S1 greater than or equal to some 40. Assume that we took 40. Our cutoff is 40. S2 greater than or equal to 40. Now, what is the requirement? If you are satisfying any one condition, it is fine. Are you following this? Then enter. True or not? Suppose my S1 is just 30 now. What I am giving it? 30. So I am checking the condition again. Okay. Will it return true or false? It returns what? True. Why? Because still it's true. Other one condition is true. Are you clear with the or not? Not is used in many use cases. Not means if you want true, opposite of that, you get false. If you give true, if you apply not on true, suppose something like this, not true, it returns what? Not false, it returns what? Usually we apply not on some conditions. It gives negation. Negation is true, false, opposite. False and false, true. Opposite, exactly. Are you good with logical? No? Now we have to talk about assignment. Another important discussion. Okay. Shall I continue or shall I stop here? If I stop here, your time is going to be wasted. Okay. So what we do now? Let's go to the next topic. Of course, only this session, it will be little, you need to listen more, but from tomorrow, you need to work more. When you work more, you don't find any, what is that? Listening is very difficult, I know. Needs lot of patience, attention, and dedication, discipline, determination. Understood? Okay. But for doing work, automatically you involve yourself. Unfortunately, without knowing all this, you cannot do better coding. That's why. Next one. OS dot, again, let me clear our screen. And what's our next one? Come on, I'll be little fun here. Try to be little, because already you are carrying a load on your mind. Okay, I know that. So now, what operators are there here? Assignment. You know, assignment means A equal to 10. You are using this from school days. What is this assignment or not? We have different forms of assignment in Python. It is there in other languages. Like this. We know equal. That equal can be in different forms. Like this. Minus equal to. Subtract and assign. Asterisk equal to. Multiply and assign. Slash equal to, divide and assign, double slash equal to, again divide and assign. Of course, difference is there, you know that. Okay, percentile equal to, reminder, get reminder and assign, asterisk equal to, like this, power and assign. We'll see with small examples, okay? And also, one more thing, we can test all this now. Shall we test all this? You take a plus equal to 2. How much you get now?
12.
How much you get? Print a. It is incremented by how much?
2.
You can also write same statement. Like it is shorthand representation. What hand? Short form of incrementation. In Python, if you want incrementation, there is no plus plus and minus minus like in C, C++, Java, C Sharp. Then what is there here? We have shorthand or full form. Suppose I want to increment by 2. then I can use like this a equal to a plus 2. This is also fine. The same thing I can short it. I can optimize it with what operator? A plus equal to 2. Same output. In the second case, it is shorthand. In the first case, it is a here. If you see, this is full form. This is short. If I should increment, you have to use any one of these two forms. Remember, from next session, when we do looping, we need these things. Next after that, a minus equal to 2. How much you get now? It means a equal to a minus 2. What is it? A equal to? So how much you get now? Tell me. Are you sure? I have done something here. And here it is 12. After that we incremented by 2. How much? 14. After that I incremented by 2. How much? 16. After that I made minus again 2. How much?
14.
Exactly. So print A. A asterisk equal to 2. Now how much I get? 28. A asterisk asterisk 2. How much I get? 28 square. 28. Okay, don't worry. That gives the answer. You know, for you, it's difficult to calculate now. Let's press enter. Easy way, right?
Yes.
Why to waste our energy there? Got it or not? That's about this. After this, you got idea about both, right? Suppose I have a value like this. I should just increment this by 1. By how much? What should I do? Tell me.
A
equal to A plus 1. How much you got? Remember all this. We need them again. With this, we have closed what topic? Not assignment. Operator stuff. Bitwise anyhow, not necessary now. Because nowhere throughout your course, you use bitwise. But if you are very much interested, I will share a video for bitwise operator. Already recorded is there. I will share that. Not to waste our time. Because we need so much time here. Now, slowly your time comes now. It's about to start. Are you ready now? First, another program. Write a program. Do it now. Simple program. Tomorrow, I will explain how to write code in batch mode. Which mode?
Batch.
Directly, you write like your C program. A program's, you know, file will be there. You write code in file. And you compile, you execute like your normal programs. Exactly. You are going to use some IDE. What is it? Integrated Development Environment. IDE means like PyCharm, like Spider. By right now, we are using basic version IDLE, which is only specific to which one? Python. We'll talk the differences also later. Ready now? Okay, let's continue. Write a program. Are you ready? Write a program. To perform all which operations are arithmetic operations. I don't want to wait for tomorrow. I'll do one thing. We'll write batch mode program today itself. Are you ready now? Let's start doing from. So far we have executed where? In Python prompt or command prompt. That is what mode? Interactive. What is the disadvantage of interactive? I'll just quickly write here. What is the disadvantage of interactive? Suppose I wrote code, I executed it. Again, if I want that, I have closed the prompt. Again, I want that statements. They are gone. We can't get back. Again, one more. I have declared some logic on top of this, somewhere in the beginning of this prompt. I want to use the same logic again, same statements again. Again, I have to type or get them here. Understood? Are you following or not? This is the disadvantage with what? Interactive mode. Once you close Python, this Python interactive mode or Python prompt, whatever you have done till that time, everything is lost. Second thing, suppose I wrote a code, a big program here, 10 lines of code. Again, I want to rerun it. You have to again Again, you have to start adding all the 10 lines of code one more time. It's not recommended for real-time development. So which is recommended for us? Batch mode. Understood now? So now, what is a batch mode means? Simple. You see in lot of websites there, people talk about it as a separate point, but not simple. Batch mode means we write code in a file and execute as a batch. And execute as a batch. All statements are executed one time, that is batch. Is this a batch training or not? Same thing. All of you are getting trained in one go. So how do you do that? For that, all of you installed Python in your machines. Many of you didn't bring your laptops, right? Okay, so no problem. I hope you have laptops. Better you bring them. Clear, right? It is useful for us. Now, as I had installed Python software, by default, along with Python, we get one is this one. You have a Python prompt where you can test all your statements, basic statements. Second one, you get an IDE called idle. What do you get? See, in the search box, you just type IDLE. Enter. What did you get here? What did you get? You get a Python shell. This is basic IDE for Python. Very basic. But for now, this is enough for us. But it's not like we are going to continue with this throughout our sessions. For some time, for 3 sessions, 4 sessions, I might use this. Later on, we will switch to PyCharm or Spider or okay, some other. We can also use Jupyter, I hope. There is something called Jupyter. Okay. So here, what should we do now? This is like, again, this is a 2-in-1 again. You have a prompt, same like what we have done in the command prompt. You can do here also. You can say A equal to 10. It works almost same. Print A, you get output. You have 2 modes here in this. You have an interactive as well as you have a batch. Interactive, you have observed now. Let me show you batch. Go to file. Then click on. Is this difficult for us? We are doing this with Notepad from since many years. Click on file. You got a window now. Program window. Type your statements here now. What is that program I asked? Write a program to perform arithmetic.
Sir, did that. I can copy paste it.
Okay, observe first. A equal to 10, B equal to 5. Now, 2 variables are enough to do these operations. So, 3 is also fine, it's your choice. You use how many you want. But I took how many? So, C equal to A plus B. Okay. D equal to A minus B. E equal to A into B. F equal to A slash B. Okay. G equal to A double slash B. H equal to A percentile B. Okay. I equal to A asterisk asterisk B. Give something, no problem. Now we should use print statement, gentlemen. What is that we should use now? So far, we didn't use print, isn't it? But now it is time for using which one? What should I do now? To print all these variables, first I'll give basic version. Shall we? We'll go level by level so that you will be very clear. So print of A, print of B, print of C. Sorry, yeah, you can print all every time it's very difficult for me to say print to print, so copy paste. This is very common operation for us in our office. Am I right or wrong? So then C, D, E, F, G, then H, and finally I. My dear online friends, I hope you are doing all this. If you are doing, you will enjoy this. If you see, then you will get sleep. If you watch it, you are going to sleep. If you do it, then you find it interesting. Okay, what should I do now? My program is over. I want to test it. First, you can save it. How do you save it? Control S. I believe all of you know this. Otherwise, go to file and say, here, can you see save option? Save. Then don't use your installation. This is installation folder. What is this here? Python 3832. This is what, gentlemen? This is a? Don't use installation folder to keep your programs. What you do, select some local drive of yours. I will use E drive, okay? I have LearnWell. Inside LearnWell, I am creating one folder. I'm just naming it as what? Programs. Python programs, okay? Inside this, I am going to save my program. You can give any name of your choice. Like in Java, you don't have any standards here. I'm just giving it as a add.py. What I'm giving, you don't need to give py, because by default it chooses what, can you see here, Python files. For all your Python programs, you have an extension .py. What? .py, like this .py. But you don't need to provide it. If you provide nothing wrong, your idle will automatically provide that type. And then click on what? Save. Program is saved in this path. In my E drive, in my local folder. But here you can directly run it. Once you save your program, go to run option and click on what? Can you see it there? Visible? Click on run. Got output? You can also just press that keys, F5, Control S. You can choose all the keys, shortcut keys, to make it fast. I want to run again. What should I do? Still my program is here now. If I should run again one more time, F5. Got it? Understood? This is what mode? Bash mode. Suppose I want this code again, then it is there in the file or not? I want to reuse it. Can I reuse it or not? Got it right? Suppose if I do the same in command prompt and I want it again, is it possible to get it again once you close the prompt? Even if you run for one time, after that, if I want to again write the same program, it's little time taking. Got it right? And this is what people use in real-time programs. We use some IDE, IDLE or PyCharm or Jupyter, Spider, all this. For us, we don't have access to PyCharm or Jupyter or all this stuff. That's why we rely on basic version. What is that? IDLE only. If you want to write some automated scripts, what we do is we use IDLE and we write the code. That is enough for us for automation. Automation in sense, nothing like something, what is that, too strange or something. Suppose I have a small requirement. What is that? I have a time, small real use case for you. How automation is done. I want to know, I have a file. Okay. And suppose, for example, there is a database. I have inserted data into database. yesterday or day before yesterday or today, okay, or now. From last 24 hours, I want to get all the records from the database and display all that. Then what should I do? Usually, what is the easiest way of getting all this data? This is a use case, what we do in our regular programming. We write a automation, because every time, you know, I need to get a timestamp. What should I get? These are all useful use cases for you. I should get a timestamp, like current timestamp and yesterday when I ran my job, yesterday's load timestamp, and I have to put that and I have to run that difference of these two timestamps. Then I get all the data. But every time, you know, I cannot check what is current timestamp and what is previous timestamp. For that, we write a Python script, which will automatically get the last 24 hours timestamp and current timestamp at a time. And that script, when you run that script, automatically you get all the records within that given time. That is one small use case we built in our project with Python. Are you following this? In this way, there are so many cases. Got it right? I'm just giving you an idea, like, you know, a real use case of Python, how it works. Next, after that, so that's about this one. Next, what we have to do after this? The next topic is we have to go for, we are not talking about strings right now. I'm going to teach you control statements. What is that? Control statements. Control statements in sense, decision making loops. We don't have a switch here in Python. In decision making, we have all this. What is that? We have some if else. Elif, all this. In loop, we have while and for. There is no do while in Python. Are you following? Okay, guys. So that's for about what we should learn in decision making. Here, at least we are going to solve some 25 to 30 basic to some medium range programs in this. Once you go to in decision making, I'm saying, when we switch to loops, we are going to work so many programs on loops also. At least some 30, 40 programs will solve on loops. Understood, right? So I told you, all the sessions which we do, we have to implement. Like, for example, one use case we are going to build right now, basically very simple use cases. We are going to start with if now. One example we'll do and we'll stop this session. What if does? Checks whether a condition is a true or false. Checks whether condition is a true or false. So if condition is true, what happens? If condition is true, your if block is executed. Understand? We'll see a small example. If condition is true, if block gets executed. Otherwise, what happens? Else execution of if block is a execution of if block is a skipped. Understanding this basic definition, basic syntaxes, basic all the fundamentals, rules is very important. Clear, no? syntax. If is a keyword again, what is if here? It is a keyword. It's not a class, it's a keyword. And it's for a condition check. Very useful. Without if, most of the coding is not possible at all. You write, you go to any complicated programming, you find lot of ifs in that programs. Lot of condition checks is done with this if. Are you fine? Now, the syntax look, it's a bit different from your C, C++, Java, C sharp, JavaScript, VBC, Shell script, Perl, all that. Might be Perl, all these have some connection, sorry. Perl are, now, the syntax, if condition in the brackets, colon, don't use braces here. There is no braces in Python to mention a blocker, to represent a blocker. We don't have flower braces like in C, like in Java, like in other languages, C sharp. We have actually blocks here. Block is represented with indentation. How it is represented? So you end with colon. After that, what you have to do? You have to declare statements with indentation. How minimum one is required. You want to write something under if block, right? You put a condition. That condition can be true or false. If this condition is true, then something must be executed under that. Yes or no? How do you declare that? That's called block in Python. What is that? We have blocks in Python. All languages has blocks, but they are declared with braces, but we don't have braces, but in Python we declare with indentation. What do you declare? Maybe you can ask me, what is indentation? Just could you just spell it or type it there? I'll just show you here. We have to use what? Indentation. Don't you know about indentation? In your notebook, you will use some space and write for, you know, appearance, beautification. Here also, indentation represents a block. Recommended is four spaces. How many spaces, sir? 1, 2, 3, 4. But minimum how many are required? At least one. So I put here, and then this is Python comment, hash, single line comment. What? Multi-line already I taught you in the beginning of today's session. What is that multi-line? Triple quotes. All of you are on same page or different pages? Understood or not now? Same page in sense, all of you are at same level. Okay, so statements. From here onwards, I guarantee you that you enjoy your Python sessions. First one or two theory sessions, even I feel myself little, you know, boring. Because the theory, without knowing the theory, problem is you cannot enjoy these sessions. So we have to be patient. Okay. From tomorrow, you see tomorrow, you are going to have a lot of fun tomorrow. I'm saying this not because I want you to be here, but I know the stage from where you start enjoying coding. Even in movies, when you just start watching a movie, initially we don't understand first 5 minutes, 10 minutes. Slowly you enter into the story. Programming is that only. Got it right? Now, this is indentation. I gave four spaces. Don't put comments for your statements in code. This is just to mention that put statements here. Statement one. And again, what is that? Statement two, statement three. How many ever you want, you put under that block. And again, all this has to be indented with same space if you want them all under the same block. Exactly. Understood? Got clarity or not? First thing, anyhow, when you keep doing some small programs, automatically you understand that. For that, you don't need to break your heads. For me, I always learn directly program. I don't go for theory much. That is called backtracking. You know, most of you know this word. I generally do backtrack. because I don't have patience to read all that theory and understand that. I straight away start working with code, understand, come back to the theory. So shall we do a small program now? You got clarity about indentation, all that stuff? You got for our first program. Write a program. This is what generally we do. Very basic program to find the greatest of a. Guys, I think you have installed your software in your machines, online folks. If you want to get best out of these sessions, work what we are doing. We have so many people here also offline. They are also working. I recommend you also, please work.
So there should be no space between if and condition.
We are here. You are seeing spaces, nothing happens. If you put also. Are you getting any error? And one more thing. These processors are not necessary in Python. These brackets, can you see here? I'll show you the example directly. There are two styles with if. One, keeping your condition in brackets. Two, condition without brackets. Both are allowed. Both styles are allowed. You can follow any one of these two styles. Finished your program. I'm using idle from here onwards. You can test them with the prompt, but prompt not always is that helpful. Sometimes prompt is little difficult to code all this also, giving that indentation, all that. But for small programs, we can still check prompt. Not an issue. Okay. Shall I do this program now? All of you solve this. Hardly you'll need how much time? 2 minutes, 3 minutes. First thing, how many inputs are required? Greatest of two numbers, two inputs. A equal to 10, B equal to 5. If I am always using A and B, it doesn't mean that you should use A and B. You can use X, Y, any of your alphabets of variable names of your choice. Now I should check this, which is bigger. By looking at values, you automatically understand 10 is bigger. But you have to check that through code. Sometimes students ask me, sir, by looking, I know answer. Why again writing code? Why do we write code? You know, as a developer, you should know this. You know everything. You know input, you know output, you know formula. All is there in your plate. Everything is there in your plate. Then what is the difficulty then? Providing a code to solve your problem. It's not difficult. No, when you understand, it's simple. If you don't, you might feel difficult. So here, what should I do now? If A greater than B, very simple. You know, you have to apply greater than B condition. Logical operator has to be used. Greater than should be applied. Write a condition, put it in brackets and put colon. Okay, sometimes we get this music from online sessions. Okay. See, if you see, I have given some space after this. Can you see here? Under if I provided some space, tab space.
Sir, an idle directly goes with the space. We directly give space.
Yeah, in idle it happens. Where it happens?
Huh?
I'll come to that. I'll talk on that. Okay. In idle, any IDE, indentation is automatically taken by the IDE itself because IDEs are intelligent. Seriously, they have intelligence. What they have? Not intelligence, but IDEs have what? Intelli-sense. They are programmed like that. So most of the stuff in IDEs are given by the IDEs itself. This indentations, it will also show you a lot of keywords, lot of program statements, built-in statements, everything will be given. Okay, now here print of what? I'm done, over. A very small program. This is called simple if. What if? Press enter. How much I got? But what is best here for us? Use idle. Suppose if I do the same here in idle, it's better, more easier for me. Got one more, right? Can you see this? A equal to 10, because if I want to make some changes, or if I want to do add some statements, which is better for us? IDE, a batch program is better for us than your, which one? Prompt program. Prompts is just for instant purpose, like brew coffee. This is like filter coffee, batch one. You prepare it, put it in some can, B equal to some file, okay? If A greater than B, colon, anyway, that's what this boy is asking, Kamal. See, he's observing very carefully everything. So he's asking, this indentation, it's automatically giving you, isn't it? Because it's an IDE, it has intelligence. Suppose this boy might ask me, sir, I will write a statement immediately after this like this, sir, print something like A is big. Then what is this correct? Is it correct or wrong? Is it correct or wrong? It's wrong. You try to run it now. Go to run, say run module. It will ask you to save nothing to worry. Just save it, okay? Big and leave it. And you can see what the expected and intended block. Anyone who knows minimum normal English can understand it is asking for indentation. That point is clearly discussed to you. Yes, sir. So what you can do now? Come here. Anything if you want to put under, if at least how many spaces are required?
One.
At least one. Recommended four. At least how much?
One.
For beautification, they told you four. But to make sure that it is intended, at least how many are required? Run module. Again, okay. You change it, you make change it, right? You made some change. Save and run. A is B. Got it right? Now again see. One more. See here now. Here I write one more statement. But you know, I was sleeping. By mistake, I put it with the two spaces under this if. Now I save this and I am running this. Do you think this program run, folks?
No.
Yes or no?
No.
Run it. What it saying? Read the error. Unexpected indent. It's very clear, right? In Python, this is very important. Applying indentation properly is very important. Initially, some Python students feel little difficult here. But I told you, everything, if you understand, it's very simple. So what is the correction? It's clearly showing where it is missing. That line also, go there. Put all this under same indentation. You cannot have what is that zigzag indentation under your this kind of constructs. Give a common indentation. Understood or not? So that's about this, folks. Save it and run it. With this, I can say one level of my job is done. We have finished level one and we are in level two now in coding. Level one in sense, all the fundamentals. Are you clear with all those fundamentals? Question one. Yes or no? If you are not clear, you are not going to enjoy much of these sessions. First thing. Second thing, we are in level two, which talks about applying all the level one things and also learning more. Learning entire Python is not a problem, but having foundation at this level, control statements, decision making loops. If you are mastering this, then rest of your coding is nothing. You got the point, right? Many people don't know this. Got it right? So what's time? Are you fine or are you out of energy?
Fine.
See, I told you should have fire in belly. Then only you can do something. Free sessions means not like time pass session. I told you very clearly. I am very serious. Okay, I am here. I told you in the day one, and again I am telling you, I want someone who has that fire in the stomach, not hungry fire. As it is 12:30, you will get that fire because of hunger, not that fire. Fire because of learning. That fire should fire. What? Ah, fire. That's it. Okay. Now, next program. One more program. Ready? Presentation will you? See, I am like this guy, like a coach, Anil Kumble. All players have told him he is making us to work hard. Now, next program. Write a program. This is simple. To find. This is actually, you know, one more thing. There are three forms of if. Before going to second program, let me give you clarity here. How many forms of if are there? We have three forms of if. How many forms, sir? What is that? Simple if. Second one, multiple if. Third one, elif. In other languages, people call this as else if ladder. What? And we call it as what? Elif. Are you following? Now we are talking about which if, no? What is simple if? Only one if. Just an if in your code is simple if. Okay. So whatever we are doing is simple if right now. And when you use simple if, the disadvantage is you can check only, you get output only if condition is true. What do you get when you get output? Suppose there is another case. When you give condition, there are two possibilities, true or false. We have to check two cases. If A is greater than B, A is less than B. But here I can only check whether greater or not. I cannot check for other. I can only say greatest of one number. I cannot talk about other number in simple if. For that, what should I do? Either I have to go for multiple if or elif ladder. So what do you do right now? Program to find to check whether a number is even or not. Number is what is that, folks? Even or not? You know even number, right? If a number is divisible by 2 and remainder equal to 0, then it's called what number? Learned in second class, if I remember. I learned this in second standard. If you want remainder, which operator should you apply? Slash or percentile? So you try this program now. The very difficult program, you solve it. Some of you, I am seeing you lost. You almost. But what I suggest is be prepared and come. When you are coming, eat strong breakfast and come. Okay. Give some glucose to the brain. Otherwise, I am going to make you to work rigorously. If okay, you should use a double equal, right? Not single equal. You should use equal equal. Samajh gaya na? Two equals you have to apply. Equal. See, in programming, equal in sense, how many equals we should use? Comparison. Comparison is done with two equals. Single equal means assignment. Understood now? So. This is very simple program. See here. Okay. Check one number. Great. Just to check whether a number is even or not. A is 10. Enough. Now, if A percentile 2 equal to 0. I have put a condition here. Okay, colon. Then what should I do? Print off. Just give some. You can see here it's giving you the syntax of your print itself. This is called IntelliSense. I told you. When you type something, it gives almost that the rule or syntax for that. But anyway, I'll talk about print tomorrow, like how to use in multiple ways, different forms of print we see tomorrow. So print of A is a even. Close it. Suppose I want value after the string, then say simply comma A. Just comma A, simple. And finally, save your program. Say, I am saving it in E drive, not in this drive. And then learn well. And then Python programs. Here I just save it as even. Enter. Shall I run this now? Suppose if it is odd, can I see output for this?
No.
No. Run module. So where is my output? I use what here? Instead of percentile, I have used which one? And that's why I didn't get output. Go to this, say run module, then save it and run. A is even. Did you get it here? Along with string, you got a value also. More readable output. Are you good now? From next program onwards, it's your turn. Because to get some understanding, I have solved a few. From here onwards, at least 5 to 10 programs you have to solve. Got it right? Any questions?
Can you
please try with the odd number? Oh, you want me to do the testing? This is called unit testing, what he is asking. I tried for even number, got some output. Let me try for odd number. Will you get any output here?
No.
Are you sure? Condition is true or false? Is it true or false, sir?
False.
9 divided by 2 equal to 0. Obviously, this is false. Percentile returns false. I taught you the year division, right? We had discussed year division. Run module, you don't get any output, my dear friend. Testing is succeeded. You should not get output for this scenario. This in software terminology is called unit testing. You have a program, you test with multiple values. That even odd, do some other nonsense and also test. That is called monkey testing. Seriously, there is a monkey testing in real time. You know that, right? But I am not a tester. If I talk too much, if any testing people are there, then again, no, I cannot. Is it clear now? This is still, we didn't do anything. We were just only in the introduction level. I told you, right? Last week I told you. You have done some small programs, but they are not sufficient. That's what I told you. Today you have done some more programs, but still they are just very basic level. Maybe I can say tomorrow you do some better programs. Next week you come to the proper pace. There we are going to work with multiple this collections and strings. Loops thing, of course. That's what tomorrow will be a better session. Not for me, for you. Because you are going to learn writing more code, better programs. Clear, right? Folks online, I know staying 2.5 hours in house looking that side, this side is very difficult. Okay, but I know there will be a lot of deviation at homes, but still I recommend you to be patient and try to utilize these sessions. Definitely we are going to be productive in Python. Thank you very much. What do you say, Srujana, Suresh, Venkat? I don't know any of you are here. Nagalakshmi, Mahesh, Komali, Krishnam Raju, Kiran, Karthik, all of you, okay? George, I think George, you know, we were there four years back. Okay. Thank you. Any questions? You have pinged me charted so many questions here. Okay. Oh, you are giving a Prasad, I'll make you to write all these utilities. He's asking me how to compare that timestamp. You come to classes 3 months. After 3 months, if you are not writing, I told you, you can beat me. This is, see, shall we write an agreement? But when I am asking you to do something, you have to show me that. Again, if you straight away come and beat me, okay, for nothing, then it's not good. You have to put your efforts, show me that, then you come to me. I'm very confident that you don't get that chance. What Jagadu Babu tells, just understand this, we'll talk later. I told you, right? After, give me one more week, and if anything is missing, you can ask me. I told you, right? I am very serious about the classes. It's not like if it is something I ask you to come free means, I am not going to feel you that is, this is a free session. I'm going to take utilize your time here. Got it right? Okay. So now that's all, folks. Shall we quickly revise what we have discussed today? I'll ask few questions. You know, being so aged people, younger, elder people, answering like in a small classroom is difficult. If you feel answering, answer it. Otherwise, answer in your mind. Okay. So today we have discussed almost all many topics, starting from the Python importance. And then, you know, definitely Python has a great future, no doubt about that. Okay, because it has libraries, it's easy. And also data science, most of you are here assuming data science in your mind. Definitely we are going to cover analytical Python, pandas, NumPy, use cases for you. Okay, whatever we do in the sessions, definitely tomorrow when you are working in your real time, this is directly readiness to the project of these sessions. It's not like after this you don't need to work. You are working means you are adding something to existing one only. Understood, right? So coming to the point, we have discussed fundamentals, language fundamentals, level one. What did we discuss there? Variables. Are you clear with that? I'm not going to ask a question on that. Constants. Are you clear? I ask questions here. How many constants are there?
Four.
You can also answer in the chart, okay? How many constants? Four. Character, numeric, and complex, and you give me answers. I ask questions, okay? Like first thing, if it is character, which class should I use to figure it? If it is integer, which class I should use? If it is you can chart in chart, you can give in the chart box, okay? Online friends, if it is decimal, which class should I use? If it is boolean, which class should I use? If it is anything missing?
Complex.
Which class should I use? Are you sure? Tomorrow, you also remind me, we need to understand a topic called type conversion. What is that?
Type conversion.
Very, very, very important. Very, very, very needful to your coding. Tomorrow, you remind me, I'll teach this. To understand type conversions properly, understanding all these data types is very important. Then after that, what did we discuss? Of data types. Anyhow, you know, operators. Operators, there is nothing much to ask questions on that. And the coding part. And we have two modes, usually interactive and batch. Usually we write code in which mode? Okay, interactive is also used just for quick test, that's all. Okay. Any more questions?